scaling up is very important for any business. This is not a choice. You need to really scale the business. And today in the session, I will split the discussion. I'll do a quick summary of what we did discussion in the last edition of scaling up so that people who not attended the last one really get some interest, understanding of what we really covered. And then we'll go on to the next topic for today, that how do you really you scale and what you need to do and how do you bring some kind of a structure in your scaling. So, and especially in these times, you know, scale has become a little bit of a back burner for a lot of companies, and they're thinking of more sustainability and controlling their enterprises and so forth. But I think a little differently. I always think that when markets shrink, you have to really think through that how you improve your market share. And I feel that the good, strong companies and strong entrepreneurs would always find a way to really see through that there is an opportunity for doing it. Like I was in discussion with one of our companies which are aggregating banquets. Now on one side, they look like the business is now on a very, very bad stage. Banquets are not working, operational and so on and so forth. On this other side, I see this would be a huge consolidation opportunity because a lot of independent operators who were running their own independent banquets would not be able to sustain. So if there was somebody who's able to really put a framework together, there would be a much larger consolidation opportunity. And I see that very clearly, both on the organic and the inorganic framework. I think there are many opportunities which would emerge, especially 2021, 2022 would be a great time for companies to really scale up and find different opportunities, not only home markets, but a lot of other markets Indian companies can scale. And I feel that the scaling up, but while it has to be done very, very consciously, because you need to really forecast your financial performance much better than we ever did in whenever we planned the scale. So let's revisit what we did last week. And we first defined, you know, I've done my own definition of what I call the scale. And I define the scale by, you know, S stands for what I call the strategy. Strategy has to be what I call short term and a lot long term. Both has to marry between them. You know, unless you have a very, especially in these times, you have to have a short term strategy, but you have to have a bigger long term strategy in mind. So how do you really define your strategy? How do your strategies or your business model is clearly differentiated, and how do you really go deep down into your business model to make it more sustainable, so to say, for next 4-5 years? So what is your broad term strategy? And I would say that this is a good time to redraw your strategy for the business. That's S stands for strategy. C stands for three different things. One I call the culture, I call it a competitive advantage, and also your core competence. How do you really bring these three things to your business model and also to your organization? How do your culture is moving up, and how the culture and how what is your competitive advantage? And third is your core competence. Whenever you're scaling up, you cannot take everything along. Find your strong core competence and focus on that. That's where the real value lies. And I think a lot of companies have let go a lot of other performing assets around them just because whenever they look at scaling. You know, for example, Gillette as a company, long time back, the people don't know, they used to also own Parker Pens. It's a big company. They used to have a lot of writing instruments, and they let go these businesses because they wanted to really focus on their core product, which was their shaving products and grooming products. So fundamentally, a lot of companies at a given point in time left their profitable businesses because they want to really focus on their core product. Whenever you think about scaling, think on core competence, think on how do you really create culture and how do you really integrate culture? Because whenever you scale, integration of culture becomes a very big problem, and stay honest to your competitive advantage. Third, which stays for A comes from actionable plan and setting accountability. They both has to marry together. You need to have a very strong actionable plan, you know, which can be really put to work, and also need to set accountability to really see that how your plan is working out and how it is progressing. And all the stakeholders, whatever be responsible for executing that actionable plan, are set to accountability, and the expectation is aligned at what is expected from them. So another area which is very important for you to really think through is what I call the liquidity, which is the L stands for the liquidity. Liquidity is that the company, when you're scaling up, and we'll talk about today's session also, would need capital, and how do your liquidity is stacking up, and what is your current state of liquidity, what is your current, you know, so to say, liabilities and you know, profits are stacked up, and how it is going to look like in next 3 to 6 months. And these equations have drastically changed in last 4 or 5 months in companies which were very healthy at one point in time from a balance sheet are not so healthy at this moment. So you really have to carefully understand what your liability side looks like and what can be the future liability, because another 3 to 4 months, 6 months, we still don't have that kind of a clear predictability, but how does it stacks up? But if some companies either have strong liquidity or can have ability to raise liquidity, I would say they are in a golden era. They would get into a golden era from a scalability viewpoint. This time around, it will be all driven from liquidity. I think a lot of companies which would shine in this time would sit, companies which would have ability to organize liquidity. And one of the companies we clearly saw was Reliance Industries, which was quickly able to raise a lot of liquidity. And I can clearly see what is a 3 to 5 year plan, because almost every good asset would come their way. And they would have ability to choose the right asset if they don't make mistakes on picking up some wrong assets. But I think this would be the perfect time for them, because they quickly turn around, unlock their value, they started sitting on a big chest on building liquidity, and now they're ready to go and create that. And so multiple news would continue to come from their group, I think, over next 3 to 4, because it's not only just liquidity, it's also to quickly deploy that cash. Because unless you sweat out that capital, you will not be able to deliver the promise to the investors and stakeholders you got in. So it works hand in hand. You need to know when to raise and where to deploy. And that cycle has to done very, very quickly, because neither the money can sit anywhere. Money has to be sweat out, and then only it creates an acting. So it's very clear ideation when to raise, and we'll talk about in the later section. And finally is execution. Execution has to be seamless, and it needs to create experience. It needs to create impact. So how does your overall execution is shaping up? So scale is defined by strategy. It's defined by culture, competitive advantage, and also core competence. It talks about actionable plan and accountability. It talks about liquidity, and finally is execution. That's what, to me, scale is all about. And scaling up, we talked about last week also on 3 P's, which I call are very important to get alignment when you start thinking on scalability. And these 3 people is one is people. Your people alignment has to come in. Your process alignment has to come in. And your performance has to be some kind of a performance management capabilities have to come in. If these 3 P's are aligned, which means your people aligned, your process is aligned, and your performance management is aligned, then I think the scaling would be very interesting. So this is what we covered the last time. So we talked about a lot of things in terms of the strategy and all the 5 elements which we talked about, a principle definition of how the scale would work. But today we talk a little differently in terms of how companies look at scaling. And I call it different cycles of scaling. And you need to really, by design, put different cycles. I call the hallmark of a successful scaling is knowing when to hit the brakes. And then only you can get to the next orbit. So that's where the value lies. You need to really go scale, take a halt, put your brakes, redefine your strategy, redefine your position of liquidity, redefine your, integrate your culture, and then start scaling up. You need to do this cycle multiple times to find different orbit change and so on and so forth. Now, today we will discuss about the 5 things which you need. If you are thinking on getting into scalability, then what are the 5 things which you would need to really bring in the business? One, I think let's understand scale and growth really comes from my own experience says only from 3 things. If you just don't concentrate, leave aside all the other things and only focus on these 3 things, then you will be able to get all your answers of scalability or growth or market share. 3 things which really can create a scalability is one, I call new markets. Which new markets you can go, who's your new customer, which you can address, where is this coming from, and so on and so forth. So new market really clears very clearly one definition. Second is new products. What are the new products which can come in and address the same audience which you currently have? And third is a new channel, which means that what other channel you can use for your growth. Between these 3 things, I think your answers of growth really comes in. And that's where the scaling up really starts on that. So now I call it whenever you are looking to get into scaling, then first step which you need to start is what I call evaluate your current position and create a bigger roadmap. So how do you evaluate and plan your larger structure. So let's do, I mean, we call it assessment map. You know, how do you put your assessment map with the current capability and organization and draw how their plan would look like and fit out on that? So the assessment map, I divide that into three parts. One is predictability, and predictability comes from you assessing how we would be able to gauge the performance of your organization and also the priorities of the consumer. So how the organization is going to perform and how the priorities of consumer is going to change. And unless and until these two are married, you will never be able to come down to firm predictability. Sometimes we lack on the performance of the organization itself. There is a clear opportunity. There is a clear business model out there, but we lack performance. Our teams were not ready to pick up that opportunity. And we've seen it many, many times. Almost three or four companies I know started when they aggregated hotels. And almost every aggregation happened in this country. There was, every time there would be six, seven, eight, nine players simultaneously would come in. They all saw the same kind of an opportunity. They probably had the same kind of technology. They all had the same vision and structure, but very few were able to go to the next level. The only companies which went to the next scaling up cycle were very clearly marrying the performance, and also they were having a strong predictability or priorities of consumer. So how, Flipkart. Flipkart essentially was a very, very close copy of Amazon. Amazon was a platform for selling books, and they were also selling books in India. And quickly they understood that the priorities of consumer is changing very, very fast, and they continue to evolve. And they also, obviously, they had the similar kind of structure which was happening. But there are many other names I would know, which were also there in the same structure, but they were not able to evolve as the priorities of consumer were changing. Now, look at what Flipkart is doing now, selling grocery, selling other things. But original plan of the business model was very, very different and very structured. I think the founders never thought that they would be doing this, what they're doing, you know, as a business model. They were not designed. Even the brand was not kept to do what they're doing now. So eventually the very clear mindset as a founders were that they need to continue to scale. And as the scale wouldn't, I think they continue to build their performance and also to continue to gauge the priorities of customers and how the priorities are changing. And sometimes I think your performance is excellent, you top class performer, but you're not able to see how consumer is changing. Like look at Lenskart. Lenskart is another great example, pure play online company, a strong online play for a few years, but they realized that whenever people buy opticals, they need to get their eye testing, and this was impossible. They did almost everything. They created online tools. They started even going to people's home and trying to test that. But eventually they realized there is only one way to run this business is running an offline retail outfit. Now, being a pure play online company is now a very large retailer in the country because they understood and adapted to the priorities of customer. So while their technology, they married, but they understood where the customer is. And they became very loyal to one what they wanted to. They continue to ramp up their performance capability from being a very technology company. Now I think they've become a very strong retail experience organization. And within all that happened in 10 years where you have evolved as a technology company, and now you become a most experienced retailer also in the country, where a lot of other players, I should not mention the forum, but they, a lot of other players, bigger companies were not able to gauge that. So these companies are like, because this, that's why they're able to scale so much, because they are able to marry these two things. The first thing in your assessment map should come, how do you bring predictability from performance and also from the priority of a customer? Second is your gestation cycles. Another area which I have seen in scaling up is whenever you start scaling up, you underestimate in some forms the market, how it is needs to be evolving, and sometimes overestimate your capabilities. So both are wrong. You know, you underestimate from how the market is going to accept you. So I call it a very clearly, the gestation cycles again has to have two things very clearly. How what is your go-to-market strategy? What time it would take you to go-to-market? What kind of gestation you see there? And second, which is also very important. Sometimes we design that we will be ready in 3 months to hit the market. We will be out there with the customer and so on and so forth. But we don't understand that there is another component which is there, which is how the market would shift to you. So the market is consuming whatever they're consuming out there. You know, say you are a new product in Ayurveda. I think you obviously have your own product differentiation, whatever you have. But there is somebody using something from somewhere already, which means that they need to also shift. So gestation cycles should always come and marry these two things together. One, what is your go-to-market strategy and what is the market shift cycle? What is the market shift cycle? How much time it will take for you to shift? Say you are a retailer or you are a salon. Now you open up in one location. One is your go-to-market, which means that how do you get to market, do your marketing, launch your entire thing. But somebody is using some salon in the same neighborhood. The people are not waiting for you that you will just come in and do that. So sometimes this structure is not very well defined and companies are not able to sustain and they start collapsing very fast because they are not able to put this right number in mind. So even in our consulting practice, now we really go down and say, what is the go-to-market time? And also what is the time frame we require to shift that market and how that compelling the shift is going to be done over 4 quarters or 5 quarters. And by the time we reach to our optimum performance or our peak performance and so on. So those things are important. The second point is your gestation cycle. Third is your organizational capability development. You know, so when you scale up, how soon you will be able to build your capability and what are those capabilities you need to really define and build. And these capabilities are both at the entrepreneur or a leadership level and also the organization level. Sometimes organization lacks capability, but entrepreneur has the right vision and right structure. They don't marry. Sometimes organization is pretty ready, but the entrepreneur or leadership team doesn't have that futuristic angle. And this creates a huge clash. And unless these two also marry, it doesn't work. So whenever you're starting to think on scaling, you need to evaluate and plan and create your assessment map. In your assessment map, go by these three things, bring predictability, which is performance and priority, go by gestation cycle, which is go-to-market and your market share, shift. And third is your organizational capability development and entrepreneurial capability development developing together. So that's how it would create results. Now, the second point, once you've done your evaluation and planning, the second point which would become is obviously capitalization. You know, and capitalization is also a life cycle. You know, it's a continuous capitalization it's rather directly proportionate to your scaling. So if you feel that next 5 to 10 years is your scale time and you need to reach to a different benchmarks, similarly, your capitalization capital base also need to scale. Now, the difference is that scale and capital raise work on a different timelines. So it needs to have at least a 12 months to 18 months kind of a life cycle for the next scaling up cycle which you have, which means that if you are today thinking of scaling up and you feel that you will reach to a certain level, for your next orbit working, you might have to start now because the 18 months from now, you would again need capital. So it works absolutely different. And I think now intelligent companies, on one side, they have a team which continues to work to fuel their number guidelines and their scaling guidelines and so on and so forth. They continue to chase that. And there is a separate team. And sometimes founders divide these roles. You know, if there are two founders, one founder who is continuing to work on the capitalization scale and someone founder is actually chasing numbers, whatever the market guidelines you have given. So you need to really see how do you position that. I always say that put a separate team, which should not really be involved so much in the entire thing. And they continue to think through how this capitalization would be done. And the answer for capital raise is today, absolutely equity. Equity is the best way to raise your capital base. And that's where intelligent companies are doing that. Even the largest companies who have phenomenal balance sheet. Again, I come back to Reliance because a lot of examples really are coming from them in terms of what they do and how their thinking process is working. And unlike what we have seen Reliance Industries in the last 4 decades, they have either used capital market or they've used debt to really do that. But they very rare you would heard that they would offloaded their own equity to raise capital. This is the first time probably in the openness they've done. And they have started last year when they started inviting oil companies to become partner. They want a larger company out of Saudi Arabia to invest with their refinery business. And a lot of that thinking process has started because they understand now for them to grow, this business would need a strong unlocking of their equity. And one of the areas where Indian businesses are sometimes not able to do that because they keep their equity too close to themselves, they don't unlock it. And I feel that the best form of going forward and capitalizing your business is unlocking your equity. So that's where, so think over it, that what is your growth need and how much capital at what stages you need and who's working on that piece for you. Now let's go into the third part of it, which is also very important and very, very critical when you look at the scaling up, is actually predicting your consumer demand side. Now consumer demand, I further divide into four different parts. One is overall defining the market. How big is the market and what is happening in that market? Is there any risk of any kind of a surprise product substitute which is coming in the market? Because these days disruption has become the biggest problem for businesses. Almost every business suddenly become irrelevant because there is unseen competitor who just shows up and he has a phenomenal substitute of whatever you're producing on that. You know, so Ola is actually, Uber is a substitute for automobile companies to sell cars to end users because they don't need it now because they would use public transport. So any kind of a disruption today can create a big problem in terms of how you need to do it. So you need to really see that what is the big picture, what is your market, and define your complete market and go to the core of your business and define the market and don't limit by geographical spaces, you know. And this is one of the areas which we struggle with a lot of Indian companies, great companies, because sometimes they limit themselves by geographical presences. They have phobia of just limit themselves. And I feel that this is a time where companies have to start thinking a little more wider and say, wherever that customer is, that's my marketplace. And how do I reach that marketplace? So define your marketplace and define the structure. Then second is break your marketplace into smaller components. Understand the smaller components. Say I was a tire company. Now my marketplace is everywhere. But now I would like to divide my components. And components would be passenger car, vehicle car, public transport, a lot of other things, industrial requirements. So multiple other smaller components would start coming in. So I would need to define smaller components in a structure that where these demands are going to do that. Then I will go third point, which is I will drive forecasting the driver for each of the component, which is what are the key drivers? What is happening on each of the drivers? Sometimes we take a broad marketplace. It doesn't make sense because we need to first divide into a smaller components and then components wise also drive what are key drivers for each of the components. So I will, if I'm a tire manufacturer, I will go very clearly understand where is the demand coming in this this component, what is the demand coming in this, what is happening here, what is happening. And surprisingly, you will find that when you start breaking it up, even in these times, I have realized and worked with a lot of companies in last 120 odd days, and I found some part of their business is still very interesting to scale. You know, while this looks like from a broad viewpoint, it doesn't make sense, but there was a component in their business model which was very promising and had an opportunity to grow. So, and that's where we start looking at it. If I look at from a broad viewpoint, maybe I would not touch that business, but when I look at a smaller part of that business, it might be enlightening. Like for example, I was doing one food brand, and the food brand is a restaurant and a delivery brand. But they also had a FMCG line between their business model. And that to me, on other side, the food is not doing well, but this particular line of FMCG, which they had some packed products, which can become a very, very large marketplace. Rather, they would be able to get a shelf space very, very fast on that space. So one has to really understand what is the smaller components in your business. While your major business might be at a certain risk, but there might be another component which would come through for everybody. And now companies are now intelligently looking at it. Now even hotels have started delivery giving the entire thing. Almost every hotel you go, they found deliveries which are working. While it will not fetch the, from a corporate viewpoint, might not make a financial sense so much in terms of what they need to do, but they are trying to sweat out some of their components where they see there can be a positive impact of whatever they do. So divide that, and third point is forecasting the drivers of that demand in each of the component, and then do what I call periodic sensitivity analysis on each of the component performance. So keep every quarter, understand that component, that how that's changed now and what is going to happen in the next quarter. Unless and until you start breaking this up, their consumer demand, and go from a complete understanding of full market, then go to a little bit of smaller components, then understand the key drivers on the each component, and then continue to do a every quarter sensitivity analysis of how this demand might change or has changed, and so on and so forth. So third part would be very, very clearly that you need to really understand that how the consumer demand is behaving and how it is changing going forward. Now, the fourth element, which is very important, is how your leadership organization, their team is designed in your organization. And leadership is just not limited to the management. Rather, I think management sometimes itself is a limiting answer on the scaling of companies. And a lot of private equity companies these days, at a certain point in time, really take a call to move the founder out. And sometimes work very well, sometimes it's not worked well, because I feel that sometimes the leadership itself becomes a very big roadblock for companies to really think through growth. And leadership at all levels, it can be at a department levels and so on and so forth. So a lot of these challenges are very important. So you need to really see what needs to be done. And I think the purpose of hierarchy is actually to destroy the bureaucracy. You know, companies, when they become start scaling up, they have a lot of bureaucracy coming. And the whole purpose of having some form of leadership and creating this hierarchy is to actually destroy this bureaucracy. Because I feel that the biggest problem in scaling up organizationally is that the organization stops behaving in a similar manner, and they create a lot of unwanted bureaucracy within the organization. And that's how the companies are not able to grow. So one of the purposes which you have for the creating this whole hierarchy itself is that you break the entire. If you feel that some form of leadership sitting at the top is actually not doing that purpose, then it has lost its point in that structure. So you need to sometimes also, I say that what I really said, you need to really slow down. So one of the areas which I say that companies, when they're scaling up, they need to sometimes take the breaks and then give back how they can bring the whole culture, which comes from the behavior and the beliefs and the culture of behavior, your organizational behavior and the beliefs you have set for the organization. Sometimes you need to reinvest back and you need to reinvest back. And that's very clearly which needs to be done. I always feel that at a certain level, maybe the founding team might not change, but you need to invite future leaders in the organization. And sometimes the leaders come within the organization, sometimes you have to bring from outside. Because I say this, that the leadership is about moving people's attention from away from what is happening in the present, and they actually give them to thinking that what is the future holds for them. So that's where the leadership is to be. Leadership should really take people's attention from the current things going on, what is presently happening, and give them a little bit understanding of what future is holding for them. And unless or until at a particular level, the same leader is not able to do that, you need to really change the leadership. And this is one of the areas which I feel the mid and small companies are not able to grow, because they are not able to get those kind of leaders who can really bring that kind of an excitement that what it holds for us. And sometimes they need to really do that. And sometimes you hire consultants and other people, they can give you, so to say, a mood board. They can give you a perspective, but somebody has to run the ship. So I feel that one of the areas which especially mid and small companies really have to see, that what is your leadership design and how the leadership is able to pass this message and bring that culture of all the belief system in the organization, so that the organization start thinking in the same lines. So a couple of things which one has to really juggle with your team structure when you are a leadership. One, evolve your leadership. Second, you need to balance between what I call process champions and business guardians. Now, process champions are people who are always very good at understanding that particular process and they run that entire thing. But sometimes they are not the most invested or most committed to the organization. And you have these business guardians which are always protective of the organization. They run like their own company, but they sometimes are not so much of a process leader sensitivity, or they are not champions of that. So in this case, you lack competence. And that's very important. At the end of the day, you need to bring a lot of competence. If you want to really scale up, you need to have a top guy in your every of us department, but you also need to guard your business, because your business can go out of control. And a lot of times I've seen scaling up has actually lost control of the business itself. And that's something which is very, very dangerous. Even including my company, at one point in time, 4 or 5 years back, I just suddenly scaled the company to a very different level in multiple countries and so on and so forth. And I lost control on many, many markets myself. And I felt that I was also struggling with these two points. how do I really get process champions who understand the process, but they might not be the most, what I call business guardians. And sometimes I bring in too much of business guardians out there. They lack competence and so on. So this struggle could always go down, but this is a very careful answer, is that how do you really able to define that in the business? Another area which you need to really balance is what we call your thinkers, your think tanks, and your executors. Again, a big difference in both of their, and I think sometimes thinkers are not the greatest executors, and executors are not somebody who really thinks. How do you marry that also? So three things I always say, just do balancing of evolve your leadership, balance between your process champions and business guardians, thinkers and executors. Understand and define your team by that. Pinpoint your team members and say, who's your thinker? Who's your executor? Who's your process champion? Who's the entire thing? And define them on the roles which are what I call very critical and important roles, and define these very clearly in your organization structure. But it all would start from the leadership. If your leadership is not able to take people from their mindset, from what they are currently doing and what the future holds, it would never happen. Fifth point, which is the final point, is how do you embrace technology? Technology is no more a choice. Every company has to really bring in technology in their system. And technology, only technology well implemented, can now help companies scale. No company I would know at any level without having a strong technology base would not be able to scale that. Now, technology further has to be divided within the organization at three component level. One is called the business intelligence side. Business intelligence is very, very important. And today, I think that one of the guiding force for a growth of any organization or scaling up an organization would be how strong they have the business intelligence. Even your future investors, if you want to really compel companies to invest with you, you need to really show a very strong business intelligence on that. And that's where I like companies like these technology companies, which have now technology-based even retail organization, because they understand every single customer, why they purchase, what they purchase, what they didn't like, what they liked, every single detail. And that creates a very strong capability. So how does your investment in technology going to understand your business better? What are the data points every single day you get to yourself, which tells you how your organization matrix is working? That's what I call the building the intelligence. Second is very easy, where every person is already, I think Indian businesses have come down, almost every business I know would have some form of process management where technology is implemented. It can be your purchase, inventory, sales, any kind of marketing function, shipping, HR, accounting. All these are having different technological tools, and all that I think is every company is doing that. A lot of companies are not investing on the business intelligence part, but process management everybody is doing. And third, which is also very important, is that how do you create a consumer interface through technology? So I feel that middle path, almost every company is trying to invest, but they're not investing on the business intelligence, and they're also not investing on the consumer interface. So if you are looking to scale your business, always start with evaluating your and planning your entire thing and define your assessment map. Then go to understanding your capital requirement. How do you capitalize the company? Understand your consumer demand, break that into four different components. Then go to your defining your team structure, especially start with leadership, how the leadership is stacked up, and be honest on that. I mean, sometimes I see, you have your son leading the business and sometimes children come in. We all love them and they're fine, but they might lack capability of scaling up. They can do another role. They can also participate as an active shareholder and a board member and things of that nature and run from an entire thing, but they might need some strong leader alongside with them. And that's something which intelligent promoters are always done. They've always understood that there is always a right time for somebody to be at the chair of leadership. And that's something which is very important for companies to do. And finally, invest into technology, divide that into three parts, business intelligence, performance management, and a consumer interface. So this is what today's section is and answer for us to really talk about how the scaling can work with you. So I would now invite Sonali if there is some question which I can answer.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your practical insights and for a wonderful session. Yes, we would just jump up to the Q&A session now. Yeah, so the first question that we have is, which is the best market globally to venture into for scaling up a technology business, according to you?
It's very difficult to say. You know, every market is a good market for technology. Technology is not anymore limited to any single market, and depends on what product and what services you offer. And I think technology is just an enabler. It would depend on what industry you are in, and then you can classify your priority markets and not so priority market and some emerging markets. It's always about industry. Technology and tools are just the enabler. And if you are just a technology product itself, then I think you have a global market. Then technology is not limited by any form of a geographical space. So you can be a global play. And from a development viewpoint, I think obviously attractive markets are developing nations, India and other places where obviously development is very good. But marketability and distribution is global. And today, what we look at, look at what now is coming in the press, where Chinese apps have been banned in India. And now if you look at, people didn't know that how many apps they were using, which were actually Chinese. They've blocked about 100 of them, and there are still hundreds of them out there. So nobody really thought, and we all used to say that Chinese is a manufacturing company, and they had no investment on the, and we are a very strong technology company. And now suddenly we realize that almost every third app which everybody was using was a Chinese app. Companies have no limitation, when they understand that there is a global market, so they would go out and use the global markets and penetrate to the world markets. So,
right. So the next question we have is, what is the right time to start thinking about franchising a business? Is there any specific milestone that should be achieved before the scale-up process begins?
So franchising, I always say that franchising is best done when you are able to, one, assess yourself that you have two things in your business model. One, adequate margins, which you can share with the franchisee, and the business is still sustainable for everybody. And second part is equally that you have adaptability of your business model wherever you want to franchise. So if the product is adaptable to that market, then I think franchising is good. And now when you think about going into franchising, there is a pre-franchising plan, which means that you need to invest into systems and processes and then venture out into that. Don't just venture out, first develop your internal capabilities, and then I think it will be easy for you to scale it up.
So the next question we have is, while scaling up, how to face the challenge of your employees copying your idea and starting off his own and selling to your current or future customers?
So last time I also spoke about this, that how does internal competition and external competition both have to be looked at. And I think, you need to really, be safeguarding your intellectual property in one sense. But there would be, obviously, there would be somebody knowing, not as much as you know, but somebody knowing as much in that. I think it should not bother you. It should not bother you, because I think competition for success is not a bad idea. Almost everything which is successful would find a competition, and competition also gives companies to be always on the toes, to continue to understand how they can better their product and better their product. By the time you are on the innovation side, you're thinking in the front and continue to focus on your part of innovation and understanding your customer well, I think competition would always be marginalized. I don't see any successful business which is out there which doesn't have a competition. And it's good to have, and sometimes, like my own company, for first so many years, I didn't have a franchise competition. And I used to joke and say, either my industry is not so much interesting that nobody wants to come in this industry. And because otherwise, if the business was good, then there would be a lot of people who would like to be your competition. And by the time you have your own way of innovation and your own structure, you will always keep the leadership. So I think keep leadership in mind, and keep your market share in mind. Don't bother too much on the competition. Competition is good. Competition should be there. almost every business should have a strong competition, and but you should have leadership and your control over your market share.
Absolutely. And lastly, I would like to ask the question which we get in almost all of our sessions with you. And the question is, so is it the right time to borrow loans, or should I wait for the market to get normalized? And or if should I just look for funding in order to scale up?
So equity, so as I said, if you need capital for your scaling up, now there is a different stages of scaling up. Somebody who needs to scale up his current manufacturing capabilities, but order book is very strong. You already have a very strong order book. Like these days, what happened in FMCG and a couple of other companies, there was a huge demand came in. Healthcare, huge demand came in for some categories. So if you have a situation where you clearly have a 3 to 4, 5 year demand being already there with you, and you have a good order book, and there is a predictability of what you need to do, then debt is not bad. And I think debt also comes at that stage much easier, because the bankers are also able to see through that where is the entire thing. Say you got a order from Government of India, or you are a supplier to railways, or you doing a metro project, or you're doing a large infrastructure project, or things of nature, where there is a clear predictability of your revenues which are earmarked, then I think debt makes sense. And I feel that debt can be a good one. But if you are a business which has gestation cycles, and you have not so clear at this stage answers of your revenue cycles, this is dependent on a lot of what I call variables available, which means that how your performance comes in, how the markets behave, how the customers shift that happens. So if these are variables, then I would say don't take debt and go for equity. And look at a good equity partner who sees your vision and also comes with sharing your risk. So then equity becomes more right structure to do that. And I feel that companies which are not determined by a very clearly strong books available for future sales should always look at equity.
Right. So with this, we'll just wrap up the Q&A round, sir. Thank you so much once again for your wonderful session. It's a pleasure having you every time. Anything you would like to say in the end?
Thank you very much. I was taking one question. Mm-hmm. Yes, Ariban, I think your question is that this question is sometimes scaling up fast comes at a cost of compromising unit economics and margins. What is the advice on that? Absolutely. It the first thing it hits when you start scaling up is your efficiencies. Your efficiencies start going down, which sometimes disturb your unit economics and also disturbs your margins. Say, for example, you were doing X, now you do X minus this from a throughput, from a unit viewpoint. While you continue to multiply the units, but your performance is not there. So when you run your own one store, I'm giving from a retailer's simple example, you are sitting there, your family is sitting there, you obviously would get the best. But then you open up a next store, it's not as good as the first one. Then the third one and fourth, then it can start averaging out. So your unit economics get into that. So you need to really balance it out so that you need to really see that you don't erode your margins. And this is one of the areas which I found that companies which started good from a scale viewpoint, but then in the rush of just scaling up, they finished their margins and they didn't know where the economics had completely turned around. And then they start taking the burden of debt to sustain that growth which they've committed. And hence, they get into a very vicious cycle to do that. And then it becomes a very, very difficult cycle to come through. So scale is a very, very sensitive thing to handle. That's why I keep saying, go scale a little bit, take a break, consolidate, scale. So that's how it should be done, and continue to find answers to improve your margins, because I feel that unit economics and margins, very, very good question, is very, very important to continue to keep eye on scaling up. Otherwise, I've seen so many examples, including one of my companies, which I invested, has a disastrous problem, because, answer for people in scaling up is throw the product cheap and then we get into scale. I mean, this idea Apple doesn't need from anybody, right? If Apple says, you make a phone for 15,000 rupees, you will be able to sell more. I don't think anybody needs to hire any strategist for doing it, right? So idea is that what Apple did was that every time they had a bigger market share, they increased the price because they continue to upgrade their margins. And that's why they became the most valuable companies. Because, you know, if this was an old strategy of a conventional, businesses, then the idea was, let's make it a little more cheaper or get a cheaper phone out there, which is also Apple, and we will be able to sell more. We will be outselling the Chinese. But this is a business call, and they took a call on margins than the market share. Just picking running by madness on a market share, it doesn't make any sense to me. Wonderful. Hope I answered all the questions. There are still a lot of questions available, but I think we've already passed our time. So hope you liked these sessions. We do every Saturday at 3 o'clock. Every week we take one topic, one time, how to invest, scale and value. Next week would be value again. How do you value businesses and how you take them to? I think we'll continue to do that. And then we'll be giving some examples and structures. To make it more interactive, if you can bring in some questions of yours, which you want, I can share with you, give you some ideas. As I say always, that in my journey has been, I've been fortunate that I worked with about 4,000 plus companies in advisory role. And I've seen a lot of success, but I've seen more failures. So I can tell you a lot of things not to do than actually to do. So if you have questions for me, and my own company has also seen ups and downs. So every business has its own life cycles. So we need to really share. And these times, every entrepreneur should really encourage to how much we can share with each other. And more we share with each other, we have collective learning and we can learn from each other and do good to our enterprises. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time today. And thanks for joining in for today's webinar.
Thank you so much, sir.